You know, a key part of most online classes is the discussion forum, especially when you're involved in theory types of classes that rely on discussion, debate, students interacting, discourse of some kind. So let's look at some of the advice that people have created over the past decade or two related to discussion forums based on significant amounts of research. I mean, this is an area just with a plethora of research on it. Managing online courses discussion forum, coming here from Indiana University. Well, there's many things to consider for handling these online discussions, and you use them because you want students actively engaged with one another and then reflecting on what it is that they learned, taking ownership over the knowledge, sharing points of view, right? So this empowerment of the learner, the shifting of control from instructor to the student. But there has to be some kind of management structure, some kind of overarching structure for them to know what to do and when to provide something, how much to provide, the timing of all these things. Good critical thinking prompts are important in the overall of your discussion forum. Reflection prompts, protocols for knowing when to go in, when the discussion conference or a forum is going to start. Your role as an instructor who weaves things together and summarizes for the students, who might kickstart and prompt things, is vital for your students, right? Making sure that students understand the type of genre or discourse pattern that you're expecting. Is it persuasiveness? Is it debate? Is it just knowledge dumping and plopping down maybe what it is you learned or observed in a field experience? What is the area that you're trying to focus in on? The subject line is vital. You know, what is that? What does that subject line tell other potential readers or discussion responders to do? What is it that this forum? So teaching students how to create a controversial subject line, but accurate. And assigning due dates. Now, due dates are not as important as modeling. They're not as important as guidelines, but due dates do typically get people some kind of structure within the class. Think about roles and responsibilities for your students when designing a discussion forum. You know, some students might take lead roles. Some students might be pessimists or optimists. You know, you might have a sign-up sheet on the front end of a class where everyone signs up, wants to be a starter, wants to be a wrapper of that online discussion. But at the same time that students are assigned roles, the instructor still needs to have a presence in the class, still needs to be involved, monitoring, modeling, and so forth. And part of that involvement will be learned from reading advice from other people on how to manage classes, going to the e-moderator's website for Maury Zaneberge and finding resources for managing your discussion. Maybe even if you're ambitious, thinking about certificate programs from Indiana or master's programs from Maryland and other certificate programs at the University of Wisconsin. But if you really get interested in this, you could pursue that. There are challenges, of course, in teaching in these online environments. There are just so many challenges in these discussion forums that you might hold. You might have students who sign up for a class and sign up to take a role in week two or week three and then drop in week one and you haven't reassigned someone to take over. That happens to me almost every semester without. This is one of the big problems that I have is students sign up or don't sign up for roles, but if they do sign up, they drop the class and then I can't replace them in time for the discussion and so it flounders. So be aware of that problem. Too much discussion, too little discussion from the instructor. If the instructor's in too much, students will sit back and wait for the almighty being to be there and pontificate what he or she knows. If you're in too little, the discussion will flounder and there won't be a whole lot of things happening that he. When the instructors ask factual questions like when did the cotton gin, when was it invented, or who was the third president of the United States, those will get immediate answers, hopefully correct from one student, but all 30 students in a class don't need to answer a factual question. And when you have students like I had, a Larry McCurley, part Larry, part Mo, part Curly, who get to be sort of obnoxious within the class, whose students, I had this one who was a returning adult student who dominated discussion, and everybody wanted to see what Larry McCurley had to say. As a result of Larry, I created a role called the bloodletter role, which gets people incised a little bit. But you have to be not only pointing out criticisms of other people's posts, but doing so in a polite manner. Now, there's guidelines for teaching online, designing protocols for how to interact, making students aware of the type of discourse you're expecting, monitoring that discussion a couple of times a week. So you may be in on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, or Sundays and Saturdays, and once during the week. But make sure that you're in a few times during the week. And if I had advice to give to you, it's to post first, most controversial topic, and be the first responder. And always post to the last person who posts. Post to reply. Students will feel as though you're there. They'll go to the online forum. They'll see you first. They'll see you at the bottom. Wow, that person's in here all the time. And yet you might not be, you see, being sneaky a little bit, okay? Spur discussion with questions and controversial statements. Out differences among the posts of your students and the as well as the commonalities. Summarize where controversy happened and how you might have compromise. Assign students to coach or question or be the devil's advocate for the week. You know, you might have a set of six roles every week and assign different six students to them, and the other 14 or 20 students can be whatever they want to be. Require reflection papers recapping what they've learned, or doing a blog posting reflecting on what they've learned in the online forum, extending that forum. Assign moderators, starters, and enders to this discussion week. Have someone who's going to start, someone who's going to end. If you're summarizing, don't summarize or weave too often. If you weave too much, then students will expect you, the almighty person, to come in to weave. Let students know when they can expect you to come in, so they know that you might be in on Wednesdays. You're not going to be in at 3 o'clock on Monday morning, okay? Announce the beginning of the week. Announce the ending of a week, so students know when the discussion has started or ended. Consider assigning students specific activities wrapped around the discussion. And if it's a blended course, you might bring in their discussion posts to the face-to-face versions of the class for discussion. Praise students. Include their names. Clap for them a little bit. Say, wow, this is great. All right, we've got them into our class. So, yeah, hip, hip, hooray. We can always clap for our students and welcome them in. Require them to post three sentences. The first sentence will say, I think, I believe, I feel, and I agree with the last person and what he or she had to say. That's the first two sentences typically. It's the third sentence where they actually finally start posting something of significance. You know, and so have them fill the screen maybe. Just I told them one semester to fill the screen, and I got more critical thinking from that one post than I ever got previously. Again, refer to students by name. Hey, Jim, I agree with what you had to say. This is maybe what you didn't consider in your particular post there. Change the subject header. If it's not controversial enough, change it. And require students to respond to each other's posts. Not only post online, but respond to each other. And if you're creating groups, create groups at least of 5 or 6 and maybe no larger than 15. Around 10 to 12 is ideal for a discussion forum. If you have less than 6, they don't know what to do typically. Include some paired activities. Include some critical friend or email pal activities so students get to know each other a little bit better in a safe environment. And again, discussion prompts that aren't going to answer. Get them to elaborate on what they have to say. And if discussion is veering off into another direction altogether, guide them to come bring them back on course, and encourage them to come in, not just at the end and when the deadline is, but early and often. Build in ways, requirements if you have to, for that interaction, and post the rules for netiquette for interacting with one another. And so I'm wishing you the best discussion forums you've ever dreamed of having. Now, there are so many possibilities for your online discussions for weaving those things, those components together to create exciting, engaging ideas and discussions so that your students can pull the threads together for themselves, take ownership over the content, push each other a little bit. You can nudge them along. And if you combine the discussions with your textbook readings, with your lectures, you can create some really interesting outcomes for your students and something they can go back and look at later and say, hey, I learned something in this class, and it's right there in that discussion forum. Good luck in those discussion forums that you're going to have.